Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of The Dictionary. I just recorded one episode, and now it's number two, so I don't think I have anything fancy or interesting. Oh, wait a minute. What is... I think... What is today? Is today November 26th? Is today the day? Nope. Never mind. Ignore what I just said. The first word for this episode is associative, or something else. It is spelled associative. This is an adjective from 1804. One, of or relating to association, especially of ideas or images. Two, dependent on or acquired by association or learning. Three, of having or being the property of combining to the same mathematical result regardless of the grouping of an expression's elements, given that the order of those elements is preserved. That was a mouthful. As in, we have an example. Addition is associative since A plus B plus C equals A plus B plus C. So in the first side of that formula, A plus B is in parentheses, and on the right side, the B plus C is in parentheses. So they're different, but they're the same, and it would be a lot easier if you could see this. Sometimes a podcast about the dictionary isn't always the greatest idea, but that's why I have the Instagram. All right, associatively is an adverb, and associativity is that like an associativity scene that you see at Christmas time? That is a noun. Next, we have associative or associative learning. This is a noun from 1957. A learning process in which discrete ideas and percepts become linked to one another. Why does percepts look so weird to me? I don't know. I guess that's a word that is not usually in my vocabulary or the way I read. Next, we have associative neuron. That is spelled N-E-U-R-O-N. This is a noun from 1935, and we have the synonym interneuron. All one word. Next, we have assoil. I think that is the correct pronunciation. It is spelled A-S-S-O-I-L. This is a transitive verb from the 13th century. One is archaic, and we have the synonyms absolve and pardon. Two is archaic. We have the synonyms acquit and clear. Number three, you guessed it, is also archaic, and we have the synonym expiate, or is it expiate? E-X-P-I-A-T-E. Assoilment is a noun, and it is also archaic. The etymology says this is from the Anglo-French word assoiler, or assoiler, A-S-S-O-I-L-E, which is from the verb, I think this is a verb, assoudre, and that means to absolve. And that is from the Latin verb absolvere. And it doesn't tell me what it means, but it probably means to absolve. Next, we have the word assonance. A-S-S-O-N-A-N-C-E. This is a noun from 1727. One, resemblance of sound in words or syllables. 2A, relatively close juxtaposition of similar sounds, especially of vowels. 2B, repetition of vowels without repetition of consonants, as in the word stony and holy. Repetition of vowels without repetition of consonants. So the vowel sounds, the vowels O and Y are the same in stony and holy, but the consonants are not the same. And there is more to that definition. It is used as an alternative to rhyme in verse. Assonant is an adjective or noun, and assonantal is an adjective. I just had to make sure I was saying that one right. This is from the Latin verb assonare, which means to answer with the same sound. And that is from ad plus sonare, which means to sound. And that is from the word sonus, which means sound. And there is more at the word bench. Just kidding. sound. Next, we have a conjunction. It is the phrase as soon as. It is from the 14th century, and it means immediately at or shortly after the time that. As in, call as soon as you get there. Next, we have a sort. This is a verb from the 15th century. Transitive verb is next, or transitive definitions. One, to distribute into groups of a like kind. Synonym is classify. Two, to supply with an assortment as of goods. Intransitive definitions are next. One, to agree in kind. Synonym is harmonize. Bum, bum, bum. Number two, to keep company. Synonym is associate. A sorter is a noun. We are going to skip the etymology. We are going to move on to assortative. This is an adjective from 1897. Being non-random mating based on like or unlike characteristics. Being non-random mating based on like or unlike characteristics. So is that literally mating between animals, or does this have some other group that this is? I don't know what this is about. Assortatively is an adverb. Assorted is next. It is an adjective from circa 1797. One, suited especially by nature or character, as in an ill-assorted pair. Two, consisting of various kinds, as in assorted chocolates. Assorted chocolates. Next, we have the word assortment. This is a noun from 1611. 1a, the act of assorting. 1b, the state of being assorted. 2, a collection of assorted things or persons, like chocolates. Next, we have an abbreviation. It is ASSR, all caps. This is, or it stands for, the Autonomous Soviet Socialist Republic. And me being a not much of a history buff, I am curious to know how this is similar or different to the USSR, which was that the United Soviet Socialist Republic, or did the U stand for something else? I really should know this. For you young people, the USSR was something that existed before, and it doesn't anymore. I guess we'll get there in the U's. But if you want to know more about the ASSR or the USSR, go ahead and look it up. Next, we have ASST. This is an abbreviation for 1, assistant, or 2, assorted. Next is ASSTD. This is an abbreviation for 1, assented, or 2, assorted. Now we have assuage, or is it assuage? I think it maybe either. Oh, here we go. Assuage or assuage or assuage. A few different versions. ASSUAGE. This is a transitive verb. Is it just transitive? I think it is. This is from the 14th century. 1, to lessen the intensity of, and then in parentheses it says, something that pains or distresses. So to lessen the intensity of something that pains or distresses. Synonym is the word ease, as in unable to assuage to their grief. And how do I want to pronounce this word? Assuage? Assuage? I feel like assuage makes the most sense to me. Number 2, we have the synonyms pacify and quiet, as in vainly strove to assuage an implacable foe. That is a quote from Edward Gibbon. Number 3, to put an end to by satisfying. Synonyms are appease and quench, as in assuaging his thirst. Would that be assuage? Assuaging sounds weird. I think it's assuaging. We have another synonym for everything. It is the word relieve, and assuagement is a noun. And let's look at the etymology. It is from, let's see, let's simplify this. It is from Latin ad plus suavis, which means sweet. And there's more at that word. Next, we have assuasive. This is an adjective from 1708. We just have the synonyms soothing and calming. So aloe would be assuasive. We have one more word for this episode, and it is the word assume, A-S-S-U-M-E. It has some synonym information, so we are going to go well into the second column of this page. And yes, I can still read all that. And here we go with the word assume. It is a transitive verb from the 15th century. 1A, to take up or in. Synonym is receive. 1B, to take into partnership, employment, or use. 2A, to take to or upon oneself. Synonym is undertake, as in assume responsibility. 2B, synonyms are put on and don. Could we just combine them and say put don? I wonder if that's how we got the word don. Put don? I don't know. That's stupid. Let's see. 2C, to place oneself in, as in assume a position. Number 3, we have the synonyms seize and usurp, as in assume control. I forgot what the word was. That's not the first time I've done that. Number 4, to pretend to have or be. Synonym is feign, F-E-I-G-N, as in assumed an air of confidence in spite of her dismay. That sounds like that should be a quote from somebody, but it's not saying who it's from or whom it's from, so maybe it's not a quote. It's from the dictionary. Number 5, to take as granted or true. Synonym is suppose, as in, I assume he'll be there. But you know what happens. Number 6, to take over the debts of another. We'll take out the part in parentheses. Number 6, to take over as one's own. And then the part in parentheses, as an example, is you could be taking over the debts of another as your own. Assumability is a noun, and assumable is an adjective. And I thought that was the last one, but there's one more. Assumably is an adverb. And the etymology says this is from the Latin assumere, which is from ad plus sumere, which means to take. And there's more at the word consume. Sorry, I had to clear my throat off mic. Something that I should be editing out, but I'm not editing. All right, here we go with some synonym information. Some more specific stuff. Some more specific synonym. Is there another word for information that starts with a s? Some more synonym. Never mind. Assume, affect, pretend, simulate, feign, counterfeit, and sham mean to put on a false or deceptive appearance. Assume often implies a justifiable motive rather than an intent to deceive, as in assumed an air of cheerfulness around the patients. Affect implies making a false show of possessing, using, or feeling, as in affected an interest in art. Pretend implies an overt and sustained false appearance, as in pretended that nothing had happened. Simulate suggests a close imitation of the appearance of something, as in cosmetics that simulate a suntan. Feign implies more artful invention than pretend, less specific mimicry than simulate, as in feigned sickness. Counterfeit implies achieving the highest degree of verisimilitude of any of these words, as in an actor counterfeiting drunkenness. Sham implies an obvious falseness that fools only the gullible, as in shammed a most unconvincing limp. So we have gotten to the end of this episode. Let's see, were there any that jumped out at me? I'm going to pick a weird one. I'm going to pick ASSR as the word of the episode, because I really don't think I had heard of the Autonomous Soviet Socialist Republic. It also sort of is similar to ASMR, which is a new, relatively new thing in the world of podcasting and YouTube and the like. I don't listen to that stuff because it sort of weirds me out. But if you want to know what that is, go look up ASMR. And if you want to know more about the Autonomous Soviet Socialist Republic or the USSR, go look those up. And thank you very much for listening to this podcast and any other episode of mine that you have listened to. And go outside and enjoy the weather. Get some fresh air. Get off your phone. Get off the TV. Go do something with some people. Be social. Get some exercise. Thank you and goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of the Dictionary Podcast. Let's see. After the last one, did you actually go outside and did you go do something and be social and meet people? I was recently I learned that, you know, it's actually very beneficial to go talk to strangers and get out of your comfort zone. They did a study where when people are on the train and they actually, well, they did, so they did the, they talked to people. They said they had the first group of people talk to strangers on their commute on the train to work. Then they had another group of people only imagine that they were talking to strangers on the train going to work. And the group of people that actually talked to strangers had a more enjoyable train ride than the group who only imagined they were talking to strangers. The second group, they had a negative experience. They got very nervous, I think, when they were thinking about talking to a stranger. But when you actually do it, it's not that bad. It's not that scary. So I feel like, and I've been working on this, I think that we need to meet more people, have more communications with people you're not used to. It's only going to broaden your horizons and get you out of your comfort zone, and it is a really, really good thing to do. I'm mostly just telling that to myself because I think I'm the only one who listens to this podcast anyway. All right, let's talk about some words. The first word is assuming, A-S-S-U-M-I-N-G. This is an adjective from 1692. We just have the synonyms pretentious and presumptuous. Next, we have assumpsit. Assumpsit, yep. A-S-S-U-M-P-S-I-T. This is a noun from 1591. An express or implied promise or contract not under seal on which an action may be brought. 2A. A former common law action brought to recover damages alleged from the breach of an assumpsit. Assumpsit is a funny word. Well, let's see. 2B, an action to recover damages for breach of a contract. This is from New Latin, and it means he undertook, and it is from Latin assumere, which means to undertake. Next, we have the word assumption. This is a noun from the 13th century. 1A, the taking up of a person into heaven. Oh, yeah, I think I've heard it used in those terms. 1B is capitalized. August 15th, observed in commemoration of the Assumption of the Virgin Mary. Was the Virgin Mary taken up into heaven? 2. A taking to or upon oneself, as in the assumption of a new position. 3. The act of laying claim to or taking possession of something, as in the assumption of power. 4. We have the synonyms arrogance and pretension. 5A. An assuming that something is true. I am going to try to stop apologizing when I make mistakes because I make a lot of mistakes, and so I'm going to be doing a lot of apologizing. Sometimes I just make mistakes, and sometimes I don't realize I make mistakes until later. Like recently, I was listening to the episode where I was listening to the episode after the episode where I did the live recording with my family, and I said that I couldn't find the word aspirin, but in fact, I had found the word aspirin when I was recording with my family, but when I thought about it later, I thought that I hadn't. Anyway, I make mistakes all the time because I'm human. We are going to move on to more definitions for the word assumption. I think I read 5A, so now I am going to read 5B. I felt a little bit like Perd from Perd Hapley from Parks and Rec. I love that character. 5B, a fact or statement as a proposition, axiom, postulate, or notion taken for granted. So it is a fact or statement taken for granted. Number 6, the taking over of another's debts. Do we have any etymology that we think is worth talking about? Let's see, it is from the Latin assumptio, which means taking up, and that's all I'm going to tell you. Next, we have the word assumptive. This is an adjective from 1611, of relating to or based on assumption. Next is the word assurance, A-S-S-U-R-A-N-C-E. This is a noun from the 14th century. 1. The act or action of assuring, as 1A, the synonyms pledge and guarantee. I guarantee. We were just talking about that guy. I think that's the Cajun chef. You young people don't know who he is, but I remember sometimes being home sick from school and putting on PBS, and he was a very white guy, but he was the Cajun chef, and he spoke like that. He would often say, I guarantee. And I think he was even on some commercials. Were they Lay's chips commercials? Correct me if I'm wrong. Let me know your opinions. Tell me your memories. Tweet me, Facebook me, email me. Tell me your memories of the Cajun chef. I would love to hear them. And if you're a family member of the Cajun chef, I would love to hear about that too. I think his name was something with a, I want to say Jerome. It wasn't Jerome. It was something like that though. Damn it. Okay. Let's see. 1B. That was quite a tangent we went on. The act of conveying real property. Also, the instrument by which it is conveyed. 1C is chiefly British. It is the synonym insurance. So when they say insurance, they mean assurance. 2. The state of being assured, as 2A, the synonym security. 2B, a being certain in the mind, as in the Puritan's assurance of salvation. 2C, confidence of mind or manner, easy freedom from self-doubt or uncertainty. Also, excessive self-confidence. Synonyms are brashness and presumption. 3. Something that inspires or tends to inspire confidence, as in gave repeated assurances of goodwill. And another synonym is the word confidence. Something that I have talked about in the past, I have been working a lot on my confidence level over my almost 40 years of life. I used to be very much not confident, but between aging and between that and some conscious efforts, I am a lot more confident in myself. I think I used to be sort of afraid that people would laugh at me or think I was stupid or whatever, and I still sometimes think that, but I just feel like it doesn't really matter because nothing really matters. And so yeah, just be you, just do you, and just say the things and do the things, whatever you want to do. And you know, try not to hurt anybody, because if you do, you might go to jail. But don't be afraid to say silly things or do silly things, and just be yourself. Be yourself. That's why I'm doing this. Our next word is the word assure, A-S-S-U-R-E. It is a transitive verb from the 14th century. 1. To make safe, as from risks or against overthrow. Synonym is ensure. 2. To give confidence to, as in, and hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall ensure, usher, goddamn, I'm going to start this example over. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts. Saying the words, and shall assure our hearts. That's weird. Okay, that is from, is this a Bible phrase? You probably know how I feel about that. Let's see. This, it says 1, JN, capital J, lowercase n, and then 3:19. So I'm assuming that is from, like, the book of John, section 3, line 19, something like that. And then it says AV in parentheses. I don't know my Bible. I was actually just talking to somebody this morning about wanting to learn more about all the religions, which I think I've mentioned in the past. So yeah, that's supposedly some Bible phrase. And they made it hard for me to say, and shall assure our hearts. But I can say it now. Number 3, to make sure or certain. Synonym is convince, as in glancing back to himself, no one was following. 4, to inform positively, as in I assure you that we can do it. Yes, we can do it. Whatever we put our minds to, we can do it. Number 5, to make certain the coming or attainment of. Synonym is guarantee, as in worked hard to assure accuracy. And a final synonym for that word is the word insure, E-N-S-U-R-E. So before we had insure with an I-N, but this is with an E-N. I'm still trying to figure out that guy's name. It's not Jerry, it's not Jerome, that's my grandpa's name. It's something like that that I cannot think of. All right, we have 2 more words for this episode. They are 2 forms of the same word, and that word is assured, A-S-S-U-R-E-D. It is an adjective from the 15th century. 1, characterized by certainty or security. Synonym is guaranteed, as in an assured market. 2A, synonym is self-assured. 2B, synonym is self-satisfied. 3, satisfied as to the certainty or truth of a matter, as in rest assured we won't be late. Rest assured we won't be late. Assuredness is a noun. And finally, we have the second form of assured. It is a noun from 1755, and we just have the synonym insured with an I-N. So we had a lot of words that were similar. I'm going to pick assumpsit as the word of the episode because it's just a weird word to my brain, and it's funny. Assumpsit. Okay, maybe one of these days I'll figure out what that guy's name is, but in the meantime, I'm going to end this episode, and I'm going to record one more episode, which will be the bottom of page 75. Thank you, and goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Thank you for joining me on this very special episode of The Dictionary. Why is it special? Well, actually, it's not. But I will say that today in America, it is the festival. It is the holiday of Thanksgiving. It is the 4th Thursday of November. And this is the day that we are supposed to give thanks. We are supposed to be grateful and give gratitude and graciousness for what we have. And while I 100% agree with that, I also think that we should be doing that every day. I really try to say thanks to myself. Basically just to myself when something goes my way. When whatever it is, if I get a green light when I'm running late, or whatever it happens to be, if something helps me in any way, I think of it, I make sure to say thank you to the universe, the world, spirit, God, holy light, whatever it is that's out there, because I'm pretty sure something is out there that I'm not aware of, or it's not that I'm not aware of, I just don't have proof of it. I like to say the universe because that's sort of all-encompassing, but I like to say thank you. I like to be grateful, And I think that it has shown that the more grateful you are for even the bad things, the better, at the very least, the better you'll feel. If you're grateful for stuff, you're just going to feel good about that, just about life in general. So go ahead and be grateful today, Thanksgiving, but do me a favor, do it every other day as well. Let's not just set aside one day for thanks. I'm not the only person to say this. I'm not the first person to say this, but you know, listen, just do it. Just say thank you. Say thank you when you wake up for being able to wake up and enjoy the day. And this is starting to sound a whole lot like a self-help something or other, and it's not. But if it helps you, then it is. Also, Thanksgiving, it is, for me personally, and my wife also, it is often a day of many, many animals, specifically turkeys, getting killed. And I don't want to be preachy about that, but we're not the biggest fans of that aspect of Thanksgiving, you know, along with other holidays as well. But it's more brought up specifically for Thanksgiving. But I do enjoy getting together with family and eating good food. So I do appreciate that, especially the getting together with family part. All right, let us talk about some words. And it does look like we're going to have some different, interesting words. I feel like the last few episodes have been very, I don't know, they just haven't been that interesting. So we are going to start with assuredly, which is not that different from our last word of the last episode, but we got to say it anyway. It is spelled ASSUREDLY, and I'm going to have some water because my voice is raw. Assuredly is an adverb from the 14th century. 1. It means without a doubt. Synonym is certainly. Number 2. In an assured manner. Synonym is confidently. I don't know if you know this, but water is the easiest, what I've heard, at least, it is the easiest liquid to choke on. It has something to do with its viscosity or something, and I feel like I'm very bad at drinking water. I tend to either, like, slurp it in or breathe in while I'm drinking it or something, so I often cough after I drink water. So it's stupid, because I try to drink a lot of water, but it doesn't go down very easy for me. So I feel like I have a little water stuck in my throat, but it definitely loosened things up a little bit. A next word is assurer. It is spelled with an er at the end, or it can be spelled with an or at the end, which coincidentally spells or. This is a noun from 1607, one that assures, and a synonym is insurer, with an I-N. Next we have assurgent. This is an adjective from 1578, moving upward, synonym is rising. And then it says especially, the 1B definition for the word ascendant, and you can go back and find ascendant. The etymology says, this is from the Latin verb assurgere or assurgere, which means to rise. And that is from ad plus surgere, which means to rise. And there's more at the word surge. Next, we have an abbreviation, ASSY, all lowercase. And that means assembly, or it's an abbreviation for assembly. Next, we have another abbreviation, capital ASSYR, and that is an abbreviation for Assyrian. And Assyrian is our next word. It is a noun from the 15th century. 1. A native or inhabitant of ancient Assyria. 2. The dialect of Akkadian or Akkadian spoken by the Assyrians. And Akkadian is A-K-K-A-D-I-A-N. I hope I pronounced it correctly. Assyrian is also an adjective. Next, we have Assyriology. Assyriology. Yep. with a capital A. This is a noun from 1828. The science or study of the history, language, and antiquities of ancient Assyria and Babylonia. Assyriological is an adjective, and Assyriologist. I found it. That is a noun. Next, we have AST, all caps. This is an abbreviation for Alaska Standard Time, which reminds me that I noticed this morning that, maybe I just made a mistake, but I noticed this morning that the episode that aired today technically aired at 11 p.m. last night, even though I told it, I think, to air at midnight this morning. So I got to go figure out, did I do something wrong? Did it have to do, it might have had to do with time zone problems? I don't know. I got to look into that. So thanks for reminding me about that. Next, we have AST again, but this one is a noun suffix. This means one connected with, as in ecdys. Oh, what is this word? Ecdysiast? ECDYSIAST. Ecdysiast is the only way that I can think of how to pronounce that. Next, we have a starboard. A starboard? A starboard. So it's like the word starboard, but with an A at the beginning. This is an adverb from circa 1630. Toward or on the starboard side of a ship. So you've got the starboard side of a ship, but if something is on that side, it is called a starboard. And we have an example. Put the helm hard a starboard. Next, we have astarte, capital A-S-T-A-R-T-E. I feel like I have a vague memory of this coming up in a previous word, either as a synonym or in a definition. I'm not sure. It is astarte. It is a noun from 1599. The Phoenician goddess of fertility and of sexual love. And it just says it is Latin from the Greek astarte with a horizontal line over the E. Next, we have astatine. Astatine. Yep, A-S-T-A-T-I-N-E. This is a noun from 1947. A radioactive halogen element discovered by bombarding bismuth with alpha particles and also formed by a radioactive decay. And then it tells me to see the element table, which we've seen a number of times, and we're going to keep on seeing it until we get to the element table, and then we are going to keep on seeing it until we get to the end of the book. Are there any elements that start with Z? What is the last word? No. What is the last element alphabetically? I definitely do not know, but if you know, without looking up, I want you to send me a message. Let us look at the etymology. It is from Greek astatos, which means unsteady, and that is from A plus statos, which means standing, and that is from histani, which means to cause to stand, and there's more at the word stand. Excuse me. Next, we have the word aster, A-S-T-E-R. This is a noun from 1664. One. We have, now this is weird, we have the etymology after the number one, because we have another set of etymology after the number two. So I'm going to read the 1A and 1B definitions, then I'll read that etymology, then I'll read the number two definition, and then I'll read that etymology. Is that a word? Estymology? I don't know. All right, number 1A, any of various chiefly fall-blooming, leafy-stemmed composite herbs with often showy heads containing disc flowers or both disc and ray flowers. Number 1B, we have the synonym China aster. And since I'm in this world, I will say that the aster 1A definition has a picture of that plant. And it's got just a stem with a leaf couple leaves, and then some flowers at the top of it. I should also say that, let's see, the composite herbs is from aster and closely related genera. So there's other ones that are similar. The etymology for number 1A and 1B says this is from the Latin word aster, which is from the Greek prefix aster, or the Greek word aster, something, and that means star or aster, and there's more at the word star. So they must have thought it looked like a star, and that's where it got its name. Now we have number 2 for aster. It is a system of microtubules arranged radially about a centriole at either end of the mitotic or meiotic spindle. I don't know what that says or means. It looks like the etymology is almost identical, but I guess for some reason they had to separate them. Next, we have the suffix aster. So it's the same word, but it's a noun suffix this time, and it means one that is inferior or not genuine, as in criticaster, C-R-I-T-I-C-A-S-T-E-R. Criticaster, is that the best example you could give us? This is from Latin. It is a suffix denoting partial resemblance. And of course, I have to give a shout out to the filmmaker Ari Aster, who has made a couple of interesting movies. Well, they would be horror slash thriller slash, yeah, mostly that. And I liked them, and you should go watch them if you're into that sort of thing. Next, we have Asteria. A-S-T-E-R-I-A. This is a noun from 1903, a gemstone cut to show asterism. This is Latin. It's a precious stone from the Greek feminine of asterios, which means starry. So now I want to see a picture of this gem. Next we have asteriated. Asteriated, yep. It is an adjective from 1816, and it means exhibiting asterism. And we haven't gotten to asterism yet. We've had a couple of words that have that word in the definition, so now I'm curious. Yeah, exhibiting asterism, and as in asterated sapphire. We have one more word for this episode that goes a little bit onto the next page. It is the word asterisk. It is the first form, and right off the bat, I have to say, apologies if you are this person, but I have to say I get really frustrated when people mispronounce this word. It is asterisk, A-S-T-E-R-I-S-K. It's not asterisk or some other way to pronounce it. It is asterisk. Let us see. What this is a noun from the 14th century. It's like the word espresso, the coffee espresso. It's not espresso, it's espresso, E-S-P, not E-X-P. I shouldn't be so frustrated, but why don't people know these things? Okay, this says, the character, and then it shows an asterisk, used in printing or writing as a reference mark, as an indication of the omission of letters or words to denote a hypothetical or unattested linguistic form, or for various arbitrary meanings. Asteriskless is an adjective. Is that really a word that we need? You need to say if it's asteriskless? Okay. Can there be an asteriskness or an asterisk ship? Probably not. Let us look at the etymology. This is from Middle English, asterisk, spelled A-S-T-A-R-I-S-C, and that is from Latin asteriscus, which is from the Greek asteriskos, which literally means little star, and that is a diminutive of the prefix aster, or the word aster with a line over the E. That's where you get it. If you didn't know that the prefix aster meant star, essentially, I mean, I'm simplifying it, but that's basically what it is, then there you go. I feel like there are some other words. Well, obviously, asteria and just the word aster. Let's look ahead. Asteroid, all those words. Yeah, that's related to stars. Cool. Well, we are going to get to those words in the next episode. But again, I have to say happy Thanksgiving. I hope that you are able to spend this day, not working. I hope you have the day off. You should. Not necessarily. A lot of you have to work because, oh boy, now I have to talk about Black Friday. Black Friday. What to say about Black Friday? It's a thing that's ridiculous in my book. It's just all about consumerism and buying stuff and spending money and getting the cheapest things that you probably don't need. Although, if you do need things, that is a good time to get some deals. Also, Cyber Monday. But yeah, Black Monday is ridiculous. I feel really, really, really bad for any of you people who work at those big stores who have to work on Friday. A lot of those stores now these days are opening up at like 2 p.m., 3 p.m., 4 p.m. on Thursday, on Thanksgiving. It's cutting down your time with your family. It's making people go into work so they can't spend time with their friends or family. In my book, it's getting ridiculous. I feel like we need to just tone this back. I know you want to get good deals. I know you want to spend less money. But, geez, this is what is happening. Yeah, so that's that. But anyway, go be with your family. Be with your friends. Be with people that you enjoy spending time with. Don't go be with people you don't enjoy spending time with. I hope you don't get into any political conversations unless they're actually productive and are getting somewhere, because otherwise you're just going to go round and round and round and I'm babbling on. And we are going to end this episode after I pick a word. Oh, darn it. We are going to pick the word asterisk because I like them. They mean little star. And people mispronounce them. Thank you and goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to a new episode of The Dictionary. This episode is being released on, November 29th, which, as mentioned yesterday, is Black Friday. I think I talked about it enough yesterday, which for me was only a few minutes ago. But yeah, it's a ridiculous day. I hope at the very least you have it off of work. If you're going to brave the crowds, don't. But if you are, be safe. Every single year I see videos of people fighting for the last TV or the last whatever just to save a buck or two or whatever. So just be smart and don't fight anybody. It's not worth it. It's really, really not worth it. So that's Black Friday. It's also Record Store Day this year, which I don't know if it usually comes on Black Friday, but I think I may actually go to a record store and see if I can get a couple LPs. All right. Normally, I just record four episodes at once, but I am actually recording a fifth one, maybe even a sixth one if I'm feeling up to it, because I'm just trying to get as ahead as possible, and I'm not 100% sure on the next time I'll be able to record. So, let us talk about the second form of asterisk, A-S-T-E-R-I-S-K, which is a... I didn't know my words for a second. This is a transitive verb from circa 1733. To mark with an asterisk. Synonym is star. So if you are drawing an asterisk or whatever, you are asterisking. Next we have asterism. This is a noun from 1598. 1A, we have the synonym constellation. 1B, a small group of stars. 2. A star-shaped figure exhibited by some crystals by reflected light, as in a star sapphire, or by transmitted light, as in some mica, M-I-C-A. That's the word mica. And as I mentioned in the last episode, the prefix aster, A-S-T-E-R, is related to stars, so that is why you got so many star definitions in here. This is from the Greek asterismos, which is from asterizine, which means to arrange in constellations. I feel like I should learn Greek, at the very least so I know how to actually pronounce those words, but also it just, I don't know, it seems like an interesting language. Next we have astern, A-S-T-E-R-N. This is an adverb or adjective from circa 1571. 1. Behind a ship. Number 2. At or toward the stern of a ship. 3. With the stern in advance. Synonym is backward. I like backward things. I've mentioned that before. I feel like maybe I should use that word. Yeah. And the word astern, pronounced backwards, is, let me see if I can do it, nerza. Nerza. I think that's right. Astern. Next, we have the word asteroid. It is a noun from 1802, and this is the first form. 1. Any of the small rocky celestial bodies found especially between the orbits of Mars and Jupiter. Number 2. We have the synonym starfish. Asteroidal is an adjective. So are sometimes starfish called asteroids? Or do they call asteroids starfish sometimes? I don't know. This is from the Greek asteroides, which means star-like. So they are similar to stars, or they seem like they're similar to stars, because when you look at them in the sky, they are small points of light, but they move. So they're kind of like stars, except they're not like stars at all. Now we have the second form of asteroid. It is an adjective from 1854. 1. Resembling a star, as in asteroid bodies in sporotrichosis. And that is spelled sporotrichosis. Number 2, of or resembling a starfish. Next is asteroid belt. That is a noun from 1952. The region of interplanetary space between the orbits of Mars and Jupiter in which most asteroids are found. I feel like I should get a belt. I don't usually wear belts, but I feel like I should get a belt that just has a bunch of asteroids printed all around it. It would be my asteroid belt. Next, we have aster yellows. That is two words. Asteroid belt is also two words, in case you were curious. Aster yellows is a noun from 1922. A widespread disease affecting more than 40 families of plants, characterized especially by yellowing and stunting, and caused by a phytoplasma transmitted by leaf hoppers. Next we have asthenia, A-S-T-H-E-N-I-A. This is a noun from 1802, lack or loss of strength. Synonym is debility. Etymology says, this is from Greek, asthenia, which is from asthenes, which means weak, and that is from a plus sthenos, which means strength. So it's the opposite of strength. Next we have asthenic, or no, asthenic. I don't think it has a long E, asthenic. This is an adjective from 1789. 1. Of, relating to, or exhibiting asthenia. Synonym is weak. Number 2, we just have the 2 definition for the word ectomorphic as our synonym. I know there's a bunch of weird words. Ectomorphic, I can't remember the other ones. But they are all related to, I think, like the body and the body shape and how the body does stuff. Next, we have asthenosphere, or is it just asthenosphere? It is a noun from 1914, a zone of a celestial body, as the Earth, which lies beneath the lithosphere and within which the material is believed to yield readily to persistent stresses. Asthenospheric is an adjective. The description, the definition didn't entirely help me. Yeah, that's a thing. It's what it is. Next, we have the word asthma. It's interesting that asthma is spelled A-S-T-H-M-A, so you'd want to say asthma, but that is not how it's pronounced. Maybe that is because it's from the Greek asthma, and they just pronounce it. I don't know. This is a noun from the 14th century, a chronic lung disorder that is marked by recurring episodes of airway obstruction, as from bronchospasm, manifested by labored breathing, accompanied especially by wheezing and coughing, and by a sense of constriction in the chest, and that is triggered by hyperactivity to various stimuli, as allergens or rapid change in air temperature. Asthmatic is a noun or an adjective, and asthmatically is an adverb. I know some people who suffer from asthma, and it sounds like it really sucks. I'm glad I don't, but I'm sorry if you do. I did have an allergic reaction to, well, twice this has happened to me, where I had a drink, and I think it was some specific ingredient in each of those drinks. They were different brands, different types of drinks, and I had some sort of reaction in my lungs. It was kind of hard to breathe, and I kind of wanted to cough, so maybe that was an asthma attack. Maybe I have an asthma reaction to whatever that is. Maybe I'm allergic to that thing, but I'm still not 100% sure on what that actual ingredient is. Somebody did tell me once that there was an ingredient that has those that a lot of people are allergic to that is typically in those types of drinks. It was sort of like a fruity drink, but I don't remember. It was a very chemical sounding name, but I can't remember what it was. But I kind of just try to avoid those in general. All right, let's do, I think, two more for this episode. First one is, which is the second to last one, which, would that be the word penultimate? I think it is. I think penultimate means second to last. And I feel like that came up in this podcast once a long, long time ago. As though, that is our next one. It is a conjunction from the 13th century, and it means as if. And that is bringing up bad memories of me saying as if in a way that I felt very I felt very bad about that. Self-conscious? That's not the word. I felt very self-conscious about the way I said that. All right, the next and last word for this episode is astigmatic. Astigmatic, A-S-T-I-G-M-A-T-I-C. This is an adjective from 1849. 1. Affected with, relating to, or correcting astigmatism. Hey, guess what? I have astigmatism. But we can talk about that later, because that is the next word. But I have to finish astigmatic. The number 2 definition is showing incapacity for observation or discrimination, as in an astigmatic fanaticism, a disregard for the facts. And that is a quote from the New York Herald Tribune. Astigmatic is also a noun. This is from A plus the Greek stigmat. That is a prefix. Also the word stigma, and that means stigma. I think, yeah, that is going to be the end of this episode. And the word of the episode is going to be, oh, there were some good ones in here, weren't there? Asteroid belt, blah, 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 blah. I'm going to pick asteroid belt to be the word of the episode because now I want a belt that has asteroids on it. Thank you very much for listening. I do appreciate that. And as I'm, you know, just like I mentioned in the last episode, I try to be grateful. So I'm grateful that you are here listening to me because I am shocked, honestly, that you are. That is it. Until next time, this is Spencer reading the dictionary. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this podcast. It's called The Dictionary. I have to say that a lot, and you have to hear that a lot, so it just gets very repetitive. The first word for this episode is astigmatism, A-S-T-I-G-M-A-T-I-S-M. And as mentioned at the end of the last episode, I said that I have astigmatism. So I'm just going to back up a little bit because I have a little bit of a personal history with this. It's not crazy. I would see commercials for, I don't know, glasses companies or contacts companies or whatever, and said, if you have astigmatism, blah, blah, blah. And I was so confused because I thought that the word was stigmatism, and I thought that they were supposed, that they should have been saying, I knew the word was astigmatism, but I thought it was a thing that you have, not a condition that you have. So I thought that they were supposed to be saying, if you have an astigmatism, but they just said, if you have astigmatism. And so I was so confused about what astigmatism was until I finally learned that. And then later, I learned that when I was getting my eyes checked a few years ago, I learned that I actually have a very slight case of astigmatism, which basically means that your eyeballs, instead of being almost perfectly spherical, I don't know if any of our eyeballs are perfectly spherical, but instead of being like that, they're slightly oval-shaped. Ellipsoid, would that be the word? Shaped slightly more like a football than a basketball. That's the easiest way to describe it. And so I'm just slightly football-shaped in my eyeballs, which means that the light bounces around in my eyeball a little bit differently than the way it's supposed to, which means that sometimes lights, especially at night, light can get sort of doubled up. And so theoretically, my glasses fix that. In general, my eyes aren't actually that bad. Everything is sort of very slight. I think my eyes are better without my glasses than my wife's are with her glasses, or even maybe with her contacts. Maybe that was her old prescription. So let's talk about astigmatism a little bit more. This is a noun from 1846. One, a defect of an optical system as a lens causing rays from a point to fail to meet in a focal point, resulting in a blurred and imperfect image. So basically, that's a more scientific way to say it. When the light bounces around in the eyeball, it's supposed to meet at a certain point, and it doesn't necessarily do that. Number two, a defect of vision due to astigmatism of the refractive system of the eye and especially to corneal irregularity. Number three, distorted understanding suggestive of the blurred vision of an astigmatic person. And astigmatic was the word that ended the last episode. In case you're listening to these out of order, or it's been many days since you've listened. All right, next we have astilbe, A-S-T-I-L-B-E. Astilbe. This is a noun from 1843. Any of a genus of chiefly Asian perennials of the saxifrage family that have simple or usually compound leaves and are widely cultivated for their panicles of usually white or reddish flowers. Saxifrage is spelled S-A-X-I-F-R-A-G-E. It's like a saxophone that is doing some fracking? No, I don't know. Let's see. This is from Greek A plus the Greek stilbe, which is the feminine of stilbos, which means sparkling. Ooh, it's so sparkly. Next, we have the word astir, A-S-T-I-R. This is an adjective from 1765. One, exhibiting activity. Oh, no, that's the end of the definition. Exhibiting activity, as in streets astir with shoppers. That definitely happens at Christmas time, although a lot of people are doing online shopping. I remember when I was a kid in Chicago, we would go down to Michigan Avenue before Christmas, and I think it was the Marshall Field store. They had their windows decorated for Christmas, and it was just a big event to go down and see what they did, what theme did they choose. I feel like they would choose sometimes different fairy tales or something. I have a distinct memory of seeing that. And they would have little maybe animatronic puppets moving. And I don't know. As a kid, that was a lot of fun. And then we would get chestnuts, roasted chestnuts. Okay, number two, for astir, being out of bed. Synonym is up, as in no one was astir. Next we have asti spumante. Two words. First word is capital A-S-T-I. Second word is capital A. No. What? Capital S-P-U-M-A-N-T-E. Looks like it has some other possible pronunciations. Asti spumanti, asti, various things. This is a noun from 1908. A sweet, sparkling white wine made in and around the village of Asti in Piedmont. This sounds tasty, and I'm actually pretty sure I've had some Asti spumante. This is Italian from the word Asti in Italy, the area, whatever, the village of Asti, plus the Italian spumante, which means effervescent, or literally the word foaming, like it's foaming at the mouth. Next, we have ASTM, all caps. This is an abbreviation for American Society for Testing Materials. What do they test? How do they test them? How do you get a job at this place? Do you have to be an expert in various kinds of materials? What range of materials do they test? I'm so curious. Next, we have as to. Two words. It is a preposition from the 14th century. Yeah, it's just the simple words as and to, T-O. Number one, we have these synonyms as for and about, as in, at a loss as to how to explain the error. Number two, we have these synonyms according to and by, B-Y. And we have an example for that as well, graded as to size and color. Next, we have astonied. Astonied, yeah, A-S-T-O-N-I-E-D, astonied. This is an adjective from the 14th century. One is archaic, and it says, deprived briefly of the power to act. Synonym is dazed. Astonied. I have not heard this word before, I think. Number two is also archaic. Well, that's why, because they're both archaic. Filled with consternation or dismay. Next, we have astonish. This is a verb. Looks like it's a transitive verb from circa 1534. One is obsolete, and it means to strike with sudden fear. Number two, to strike with sudden and usually great wonder or surprise, as in, was too astonished to speak. I think it's funny that in one case it's fear, and in the other case it's wonder or surprise. We have another synonym, or we have a synonym for this one. It's the word surprise. And the etymology says this is probably from the earlier word astani, A-S-T-O-N-Y. It's from the Middle English astanen, or astanin, which is from the Anglo-French estonnere, which means to stun. This is from the Latin ex plus tonare, which means to thunder. And then adding the ish, as in abolish. And there's more at the word thunder. Next we have astonishing. This is an adjective from 1593. Causing astonishment. Synonym is surprising, as in an astonishing discovery. Don't you love it when those things happen? You discover something, and it's astonishing, and then you are astonished. Astonishingly is an adverb. That discovery was astonishingly astonishing. I don't know. Okay, next we have astonishment. This is a noun from 1566, 1a, the state of being astonished. 1b, we have the synonym consternation. 1c has the synonym amazement. Number two, something that astonishes, a cause of amazement or wonder. Now we have astound. It is the first form of to. This one is an adjective from the 14th century, and it is archaic. Overwhelmed with astonishment or amazement. Synonym is astounded. Second form of astound is a transitive verb from 1603. To fill with bewilderment or wonder. Synonym is surprise. We've seen that word a lot. Next, we have astounding. This is an adjective from 1586. I don't know why I said astounding that way. It sounded like I was going to say something else, but I wasn't. The definition says, causing astonishment or amazement, as in an astounding revelation. And astoundingly is an adverb. Now we have a prefix. It is A-S-T-R or A-S-T-R-O. And this is, I don't, it's just a prefix and it doesn't give me a year like the prefixes always don't give me a year. The definitions, so there's a number of ones between, what do they call those? Colons. It's not like one, two, three, they just have colons. So the first one is star. The second one is heavens. Third one is outer space. And the fourth one is astronomical. So we have an example, I guess, for all of those. It is the word astrophysics. Our good friend Neil deGrasse Tyson is an astrophysician? Would you? No, astrophysicist. There's that word. And he has had some other astro... now I forgot the word again. Astrophysicist? Yeah, that's the word. He's had some other ones on his various shows and podcasts and stuff, including one of them, Charles Liu. He has had him on a lot, and they know a lot about a lot of stuff, and I am super impressed with their abilities. So yeah, that is the prefix astro. The etymology says this is from the Greek word astron, and there's more at the word star. Next we have astradal. It is the first form. It is an adverb from 1697, on or above and extending onto both sides. Synonym is astride. So now we have the second form of astraddle. It is a preposition from 1935, with one leg on each side of. I wonder how this is different from the actual word straddle. So I guess if you straddle something, that is the verb. But if you are astraddle, then you are in the form of straddling? I don't know. But astride is also a synonym for this one as well. Next we have astragal or astragal. I think it's astragal. A-S-T-R-A-G-A-L. This is a noun from 1563. If I didn't look at the pronunciation guide, I'd probably want to say astragal. Because it's with a G-A-L at the end. Number one, a narrow, half-round molding. Number two, a projecting strip on the edge of a folding door. So probably people who are contractors, architects, anybody who's into home design, they are probably familiar with astragal, but this is Greek to me. Speaking of Greek, this is from the Greek astragalos, which means neck vertebrae, or molding, and it is akin to the Greek astakos, which means lobster, what? And osteon, or osteon, which means bone, and there's more at the word osseous, O-S-S-E-O-U-S. That is a fascinating word. Maybe I can find a picture of that. Astragal. Now we have probably a related word, astragalus. Astragalus? A-S-T-R-A-G-A-L-U-S. This is a noun from 1541. One is plural. So there's a plural form, which is astragali, with an or astragali. So it has an L-I at the end. And the definition is just the one definition for the second form of the word talus, T-A-L-U-S. So that would be the synonym for this. When we get to the T's, we will read the first definition of the second form of the word talus, and we will now know what the one definition for astragalus means. But let's read the number two definition. It says, the dried root of an Asian milk vetch. What's a vetch? Used especially as a remedy in Chinese herbal medicine. Also, a preposition or extract of this root. And we have a scientific name for this. It is Astragalus membranacus, or membranaceus. And I'm going to see if I can find a picture of that. And I also need to learn what a milk vetch is. What is that? Okay. The etymology says this is from the Greek astragalos, which I think the last one was as well, which means neck vertebrae or vertebra. Also ankle joint. Also milk vetch. And it says it's from the vertebra-like appearance of the flower clusters. So the clusters of the flower of this plant look like the vertebrae in a neck, I guess. Next, we have astrakhan, or astrakhan. Astrakhan. This is a noun. It is often capitalized. It is from 1766. 1. Karakul of Russian origin. Karakul is Karakul, and it is probably mispronounced. Number 2. A cloth with a usually wool, curled, and looped pile resembling karakul. And now I need to go look up what karakul is, because I don't know what that is. But this is from, I guess it's a town called Astrakhan in Russia, spelled the same way. And now we are at our last word of the episode. It is astral, A-S-T-R-A-L. This is an adjective from 1605. 1. Of relating to or coming from the stars, as in astral influences. Also as in unusual astral occurrences. Number 2. Of or relating to a mitotic or meiotic aster. And I feel like I remember, let's look back at aster. Oh, that was from the previous page. I remember reading those words. Yeah, here we go. The word aster. The number 2 definition said a system of microtubules arranged radially around a centriole at either end of the mitotic or meiotic spindle. I have no idea if that helped anything, but I said it anyway. Okay, number 3, for astral, of or consisting of a supersensible substance, held in theosophy to be next above the tangible world in refinement. What did I just read? I like the phrase supersensible substance. That would be a good band name. If you want to use it, go ahead. What's theosophy? Anybody know what that is? I don't. All right, we are going to move on to 4A for astral, and we just have the synonym visionary. 4B says elevated in station or position. Synonym is exalted. Astrally is an adverb, and we don't really have any interesting etymology to read, so if you want to know more about that, you can go look it up. And let's see, I've heard of this thing called astral projection. You've probably heard it as well. I've talked to some people who said that they used to be able to do that when they were a kid. I've heard of a lot of people who say that they can do this. It's kind of just accepted that it is a thing that that happens sometimes, or that some people can do. I've never been able to do it, to my knowledge. I've never experienced anything like this. I think it would be amazing to be able to do it if it truly does exist. Personally, because I've never experienced it, I have no proof. I'm a skeptic. I believe it, but I want to believe it, but you know, I just don't know. So if you have any stories about astral projection, please let me know. Tell me what it is. Tell me what has happened. But I feel like I've just heard too many stories that sort of all match up. So it seems like it's kind of hard not to believe that it has existed or does exist in some form. So that is it for this episode. Honestly, I was thinking about picking astigmatism as the word of the episode because I personally have astigmatism, but I sure do love me some Asti Spumante. And I do love the idea of astral projection and all that, but I don't even remember what I picked asteroid belt yesterday. So I'm going to pick astigmatism as the word of the episode. All you astigmatic people, you can be happy that I picked a word of something that is related to you. And until next time, this is Spencer reading the dictionary. Holy crap, how did my episode start to get so long? I gotta shut up. Okay, bye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. I have been having long episodes, so I need to get to the word right away. The first word is astray, A-S-T-R-A-Y. This is an adverb or adjective from the 14th century. 1. Off the right path or route, some people want to say. And a synonym is straying, with an ing. Number 2. In error, away from what is proper or desirable. The etymology says this is from Anglo-French, estrayer, which means wandering, from estraire, which means to stray, and there's more at the word stray. Now we have the word astride, A-S-T-R-I-D-E. It is the first form. It is an adverb from 1610. 1. with one leg on each side, astride a horse. That wasn't even an example. That was just part of the definition. But we do have an example. It says, she rode astride, not side saddle. And remember, this is not a straddle. This is astride. Number two, with the legs stretched wide apart, as in standing astride. Now we have the second form of astride. It is a preposition from 1653. One, on or above and with one leg on each side of, as in astride a horse. I sense a pattern. Number two, placed or line on both sides of, as in towns line astride a river. Number three, extending over or across. Synonym is, two synonyms, spanning and bridging. Now we have astringency. It would help if I could actually say it. This is a noun from 1601. The quality or state of being astringent. Which is our next word? It is the first form of two. It is an adjective from 1541. One, causing contraction of soft organic tissues. And a synonym is styptic, S-T-Y-P-T-I-C, and another one is puckery. Okay. We have examples. Astringent lotions, or an astringent fruit. Number two, suggestive of an astringent effect upon tissue, rigidly severe. A synonym is austere. And I gotta throw in, there is a They Might Be Giants song called James K. Polk. And let me see if I can remember. So basically, it's a song about James K. Polk, a president from back in the day. And I think they actually rhyme austere, severe. Austere, severe, he held through few people dear. I don't think my notes were quite right, but maybe I can put in a clip.
Austere, severe, he held few people dear.
We have an example. Dry, astringent comments. Also, we have these synonyms at the end, pungent and caustic. Astringently is an adverb. Now we have the second form of astringent. It is a noun from 1626, an astringent agent or substance. Sorry, I had to burp off mic. Now we have the word astrobiology. It is one word. It is a noun from 1955, and we have the synonym exobiology. And astrobiologist is a noun. Next we have astrocyte. A-S-T-R-O-C-Y-T-E. This is a noun from 1898, a large star-shaped cell of the glia, G-L-I-A. Astrocytic is an adjective. Next is astrocytoma or astrocytoma. This is a noun from circa 1923, a nerve tissue tumor composed of astrocytes, the thing that we just talked about. Next, we have astrodome. I would want to say astrodome, but I guess that would be the place. What is that? There's a football stadium, I think, called the Astrodome. But this looks like it is pronounced astrodome, not a long O. This is a noun from 1941, a transparent dome in the upper surface of an airplane from within which the navigator makes celestial observations. Which I think basically means that they use the stars to navigate, maybe? Oh, that would be so cool. I do not know constellations. I don't know my constellations. That doesn't help me. I know where the North Star is, but that's about it. Okay, next, the Big Dipper, Orion's Belt, I know that, but that's about it. Next we have astral, A-S-T-R-O-L. This is an abbreviation for astrologer or astrology. Next, we have astrolabe, L-A-B-E, at the end. This is a noun from the 14th century, a compact instrument used to observe and calculate the position of celestial bodies before the invention of the sextant. So, the sextant is... it is a thing. Oh, I saw one recently that was old. I honestly don't know enough about them to even describe how it works, but I think it has something to do with lining up the moon or the sun on the horizon, and It'll tell you something about some stuff and things. But an astrolabe is an earlier version. So theoretically, the sextant is better than the astrolabe. A lot of people now, they're traveling on boats or wherever, or planes, and they have GPS, so they're fine. But what if electricity goes out? Your GPS might not work. What if all the satellites, who knows? You gotta, if you're gonna be navigating stuff in water, wherever, you need this stuff. You should know it. All right, let's simplify the etymology. It is from the Greek astrolabos, which is from aster prefix plus labanin, which means to take, and there is more at the word latch. Next, we have astrologer. This is a noun from the 14th century, a person who practices astrology. And we are going to move right into the word astrology. This is a noun from the 14th century. One is archaic. We just have the synonym astronomy. Number two, the divination of the supposed influences of the stars and planets on human affairs and terrestrial events by their positions and aspects. And that reminds me of a Weird Al song, which is all, I think it's called Your Horoscope for Today, something like that. And there is a really great part, I think it would be called the bridge of the song, where he gives an explanation about what astrology is, very similar to what I just read, but it's all very fast, and it seems like it's all in one breath, so maybe I'll put a clip of that in here, too. I think I'm starting to want to put some clips in of things, because it's fun.
Now you may find it inconceivable, or at the very least a bit unlikely, that the relative position of the planets and the stars could have a special deep significance, or meaning that exclusively applies to only you. But let me give you my assurance that these forecasts and predictions are all based on solid scientific documented evidence. So you would have to be some kind of moron not to realize that every single one of them is absolutely true. Where was I?
Yeah, I've always really liked that part of the song. Astrology is interesting. I want to believe it. I do find it interesting. It does seem like that there are some patterns with what you get from astrology, but at the same time, the more logical part of my brain, scientific part of my brain, says it's all ridiculous and it doesn't really mean anything. So I don't know. I go sort of back and forth on that. But take it with a grain of salt. Astrological is an adjective, and astrologically is an adverb. And now I have to figure out where we are going to end this episode. I think we're going to do two more. Next word is astrometry. It is a noun from circa 1859, a branch of astronomy that deals with measurements, as of positions and movements, of celestial bodies. And astrometric is an adjective. And we're going to do the last word for this episode. It is an abbreviation. It is the word astron, A-S-T-R-O-N, and that is an abbreviation for astronomer or astronomy. Not to be confused with astral, which is an abbreviation for astrologer and astrology. It is easy to get those confused. All right, so what is the word of the episode? Let's just go ahead and pick astrology as the word of the episode, because it's something that I think is interesting, but who knows? Who knows if it's a real thing or not? And that's kind of all I have to say about that. Thank you very much for listening. I tried to make this short, and I did, so thank you and goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of The Dictionary. I was so excited to try and make last episode short that I forgot to say Happy December. Yesterday was December 1st. Today is December 2nd. We are getting near to the year 2020, people. Oh, it's so weird when you watch a movie or something and it says something like, the year is 1997. It's been 40 years since the planet blew up or something. That was a long time ago in today's time. So that's just weird to me. All right, the first word for this episode is astronaut, A-S-T-R-O-N-A-U-T. This is a noun from 1929, a person who travels beyond the Earth's atmosphere, Also, a trainee for spaceflight. And we are going to move on to astronautics. This is a noun from 1928. The science of the construction and operation of vehicles for travel in space beyond the Earth's atmosphere. Astronautic or astronautical, those are both adjectives, and astronautically is an adverb. Next we have astronomer. This is a noun from the 14th century, a person who is skilled in astronomy or who makes observations of celestial phenomena. Next is astronomical. This is, could it also be astronomic? This is an adjective from 1556. One, of or relating to astronomy, as in astronomical observations or astronomic observations. Number two, enormously or inconceivably large or great, as in astronomic numbers. I'm just going to give you the one example. Astronomically is an adverb. Now we have astronomical unit, and I think this can be abbreviated to just the letters AU, which I assume we will get to in the future. So astronomical unit, it is two words. It is a noun from 1903, a unit of length used in astronomy equal to the mean distance of the Earth from the Sun, or about 93 million miles, which is 150 million kilometers. So if you don't know, throughout the year, the Earth will be a certain distance away from the Sun. At one point of the year, it's closer, and another part of the year, it's further away. So clearly, it's not the same throughout the year. So they just take the average or the mean distance, which is about 93 million miles. And that is one astronomical unit. So if you ever see something that says, oh, it's 7 AUs, that means it is 7 times 93 million miles, or 7 times 150 million kilometers. And that is how far away that is. This is different from light years. That is also a unit of distance, but it is very different. We'll get to that later. That's for another conversation. Next, we have the word astronomy. This is a noun from the 13th century. The study of objects and matter outside the Earth's atmosphere and of their physical and chemical properties. Excuse me. Next, we have astrophotography. I like this. This is a noun from circa 1858. Photography involving astronomical objects and events. Astrophotograph is a noun, and astrophotographer is also a noun, but they are different nouns. I haven't really gotten into astrophotography. Only a couple of times have I taken relatively decent photos of the stars. I think I have a couple that are relatively handy that maybe I could post on Instagram. One was shot with a very wide angle when we were up in the Pacific Northwest one night. I think it was a new moon, so it was very dark out, and we were just in an area outside of a city that just had tons and tons and tons of stars. And so I did what I could. It's not a great photograph. You can maybe sort of make out the Milky Way, but it's still pretty faded. I've seen better ones. But I also was very lucky enough to be in Iceland just at the very beginning of the year where you could start to see the Aurora Borealis. We also call that the Northern Lights. Although I think there are Southern Lights too. That might have a different name. But yeah, my wife and I were there in, I think it was middle or late August. And so we were right on the edge of whether or not we could see them. And I went outside one night and I thought that I could sort of make it out, and I was ready. I had my camera, so I went and I got it. I put it on a little tripod and I shot it straight up into the sky, and I shot maybe a 30-second exposure or something like that. And absolutely, it was the Northern Lights. It was this sort of greenish blue hue. And so I shot a time lapse of it, and it was, you know, it's not, I've seen cooler photos and time lapses of of the Northern Lights, but the fact that I was able to get a relatively decent video time-lapse of the Northern Lights, I was like, okay, that was one of my bucket list items. I could die happy. That was so cool. I'll see if I can and post that on Instagram or something. That is my experience with astrophotography. So technically, I'm an astrophotographer. All right, next we have astrophysics. This is a noun. I feel like I should have Neil deGrasse Tyson as a guest here. Or any other astrophysician. See, there I did it again. Astro, what is the word? Here, astrophysicist. That's the word. It tells me right there. I feel like I should have one of you guys on to be a guest reader for this episode, but sorry, you missed your chance. All right, this astrophysics, it is a noun from 1890, a branch of astronomy dealing especially with the behavior, physical properties, and dynamic processes of celestial objects and phenomena. Astrophysical is an adjective, astrophysically is an adverb, and astrophysicist is a noun. It's not astrophysician. I went off mic a little bit. It's not astrophysician. That would be a person who helps make stars get better when they have the flu. I'm sure there's a good pun in there somewhere. All right, next we have AstroTurf. It is one word with a capital A. This is a trademark used for artificial turf. That's the definition. Next we have astute. You could also say astute, like a astute. This is an adjective from 1565. Having or showing shrewdness and I know this word, but I'm going to blank on it. Perspicacity. That's not how you pronounce it. Perspicacity. Well, maybe. We have an example. An astute observer. Also is in astute remarks. Also, we have the synonyms crafty and wily. Perspicacity. I'm just going to keep on trying to say that word. That might be right. Probably not, but maybe. We have another synonym at the end. I don't know why they are putting it here separate from all the other ones, but it is the word shrewd. Astutely is an adverb, and astuteness is a noun. Next, we have astyanax. Astyanax, capital A, S-T-Y-A-N-A-X. This is a noun from 1567. A son of Hector and Andromache, I don't know that name. A son of Hector and Andromache, hurled by the Greeks from the walls of Troy. And I feel your pain. I'm sorry I am not pronouncing this correctly. We probably read it earlier in the dictionary, but maybe not. They can't have all the Greek gods and names of people listed in here. But when I'm on your side and I hear somebody pronouncing a word incorrectly that I know how to pronounce, I get really frustrated, so apologies. It is spelled Andromache. And it also goes over to the second line, so the parts of the word are just completely apart from each other. Andromache, who knows? Nobody knows. Next we have asunder. This is an adverb or an adjective from the 14th century. One, into parts. That's the whole definition. As in, torn asunder. Number two, apart from each other in position. As in, wide asunder. Next is ASV, all caps. This is an abbreviation for American Standard Version. Now we have ASW, all caps. This is an abbreviation for anti-submarine warfare. You could probably also say anti-submarine warfare. Next is a swarm. This is an adjective from 1830, filled to overflowing. Synonym is swarming, as in streets aswarm with people. People don't really talk like that much anymore. I really don't hear words like this used. Next, we have the phrase, as well as. It is a conjunction from the 15th century, and it is the first form of this phrase. It means, and in addition. And then we have a synonym. It is the word, and. And then we have an example. Brave as well as loyal. You could also say brave and loyal. Now we have the second form of this phrase, as well as it is a preposition from 1589. The definition is in addition to, and the synonym is the word besides. And the example is the coach, as well as the team, is ready. Now we have the word a swirl. This is an adjective from 1877, being in a swirl. And the synonym is swirling. Swirling, swirling. I don't know why I did that. Next we have a swoon. This is an adjective from the 14th century. Being in a swoon. Synonym is dazed. Next we have the word asylum. This is a noun from the 15th century. This is probably the longest definition of this episode, or the longest set of definitions for this episode. Number one, an inviolable place of research. That's the word refuge. Okay. An inviolable place of refuge and protection, giving shelter to criminals and debtors. Okay. Synonym is sanctuary. Number two, a place of retreat and security. Synonym is shelter. Number three, the protection or inviolability afforded by an asylum. And the synonym is refuge. I think I said the other one a little bit weird. Refuge. It is the word refuge. 3B, protection from arrest and extradition given especially to political refugees by a nation or by an embassy or other agency enjoying diplomatic immunity. Number four, an institution for the care of the destitute or sick and especially the insane. And I wonder if these days if that definition has been updated a little bit. This dictionary isn't ridiculously old, but maybe just a little bit. You know, maybe those are the proper terms for this word. I don't know. We are going to do one more for this episode. It is asymmetrical. Asymmetrical. Could also be just asymmetric. It is an adjective from 1690. Number one, not symmetrical. Number two, it says it's usually the form asymmetric. And it says also it is of a carbon atom. And the definition is bonded to four different atoms or groups. Asymmetrically is an adverb, and asymmetry is a noun. The etymology is Greek from asymmetria, which means lack of proportion. And that is from asymmetros, which means ill-proportioned. And that is from a plus symmetros, which means symmetrical. So this is one of those classic examples where we put the A before the word and it makes it the opposite. I remember in art classes when I was younger, we would talk about symmetry and asymmetry. And, you know, if you can do asymmetry correct, the image or whatever it is that you're making can still be balanced and still feel right. But art is subjective, so who the hell cares, really? Let's see, what is the word of the episode? There were a lot of good ones here. I can do a photo for that. I want to pick something different. I want to do something different. What are we going to do? I'm going to pick astronaut, the very first word of the episode. That is going to be the word of the episode because I'm impressed with astronauts. They know a lot about a lot of stuff. They need to know a lot. They need to be engineers and science people, and I don't even know. I can't even think of all the words of the things that they need to know about. They're just super smart people. Oh, they're often pilots, and I already said engineers, but I'm going to say it again. I'm just really impressed with anybody who's ever been an astronaut. It took a lot of training, a lot of knowledge to get to that point. And I'm jealous because they get to go up in space and zero G and experience that. And that is just, it just boggles the mind, my mind at least. So thank you very much for listening. These episodes are definitely getting longer and I'm not trying to do that. And thank you. This is Spencer reading the dictionary. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of the Dictionary Podcast, hosted by me, Spencer. Although In today's episode, you will be getting a guest reader. In fact, the next three episodes will be guest readers, two different people doing two episodes each. And I did want to give a little behind-the-scenes information before we get into them. For these four episodes, and these might actually be the only ones that I've done this with so far, I actually write out a little script for the people who are doing these because they live other places. We can't get together physically. And so they just record them on their own. So I write a little script with just the basics of what the word is and the definitions and all that. There's no pronunciation guide, so they may mispronounce a few of the words. Give them a break, people. They don't have me there to guide them. They don't have the pronunciation guide. So yeah, just let that slide. But I'm grateful that they did this at all, that they were interested in doing this. I think both of them said that was a lot harder than I thought it would be. So I make this look easy, people. Don't forget that. But if you want to be a guest reader, let me know. So we are going to get into the first guest reader episode. This is Daniel Kaka from the Weird Alphabet Podcast.
Hello, word nerds. You may notice that the voice is a little different this week because this is not Spencer. This is Daniel Kaka from the Weird Alphabet Podcast. If you want to check out our other podcast, The Weird Alphabet, you can check that out. We are on iTunes and wherever you can find us on any podcatcher of your choice. Anyway, word nerds, let's get on with the words. All right, we are on page 77. Asymptomatic, adjective from 1856, presenting no symptoms of disease. Asymptomatically is a verb. Asymptote, noun from 1656, a straight line associated with a curve such that as a point moves along with an infinite branch of the curve, the distance from the point to the line approaches zero, the slope of the curve, and the point approaches the slope of the line. Asymptotic is an adjective, and asymptotically is an adverb. The etymology from Greek asymptotos, which means not meeting, from a sympatine, which means to meet. And there's more at the word symptom. A synapsis, noun from 1930, failure of pairing of homogeneous chromosomes in meiosis. Asynchronous, adjective from 1748. Let's see, first meaning, not synchronous. Oh, I always find it weird whenever they put in definitions of words and they put in part of the word into the definition. I'm not really learning what that word means when they do that. All right, well, there is a second definition. Hopefully this will help explain asynchronous. Of used in, of being digital communication, as between computers, in which there is no timing required for transition, in which the start of each character is individually signaled by the transmitting device. Asynchronously is an adverb. Asynchrony, or asynchronism, noun from 1875, the quality or state of being asynchronous. Okay. Again, with the putting the word in the definition. Absent or lack of concurrence in time. Asyndetic, adjective from circa 1864, marked by asyndetone. Asyndetically is an adverb. Asyndeton, noun from 1555, omission of the conjunctions that ordinarily join coordinating words or clauses, as in, quote, I came, I saw, I conquered. Etymology, it's from Greek, from the neutral asyndetos, which means unconnected, from a syndetos, which means bond together, from sin, dien, which means to bind, and there's more at the word diadem. Woo! Those are some complicated words. Okay. At, first form, preposition from before the 12th century. Definition 1. Used as a function word to indicate the goal of an indicated or implied action or motion. Example, staying at a hotel, at the party, or sick at heart. Definition 2. used as a function word to indicate the goal of the indicated or implied action or motion. Examples: aim at the target and creditors are at him again. Definition 3, use as a function word to indicate that with which one is occupied or employed. Examples: at work, at the controls, good at chest. Definition 4, use as a function word to indicate situation in an active or passive state or condition. Examples: at liberty and at rest. Definition 5, used as a function word to indicate the means, cause, or manner. Examples: sold at auction, laughed at my joke, and act at your own discretion. All right, definition 6A, used as a function word to indicate the rate, degree, or position in a scale or series. The temperature at 90 and at first. Definition 6B, use a function word to indicate age or position of time, as in will retire at 65. Whew, who knew there were so many definitions for the word at? Oh, and there's even more. Woo, got a lot. All right, let's keep going. At, second form, also at, A-T-T. Noun from 1955, see Kip in the money table. Etymology, from Laos. At, third form, abbreviation for airtight, atmosphere, or atomic. At, symbol for acetane. And then we have AT, abbreviation for air temperature, ampere turn, automatic transition. And then there's at, which is prefix, C-A-D. Atabrine, that's A-T-A-B-R-I-N-E. Noun from 1933. There's no definition, just the synonym quinacrine. Etymology from atabrine, which means trademark. All right. So I think the word of the day has got to be at. Definitely. It's a word that's very commonly used, and who knew that there were so many different definitions for it. So yeah, there it is. Word of the day, at.
Thank you very much to Daniel for doing this, and you will hear him in the next episode as well. He's got a whole other set of words that he's got to get through. So until next time, this is Spencer reading the dictionary, and sometimes it's Daniel, and sometimes it's somebody else. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of the Dictionary Podcast. You are going to be hearing Daniel again in mere moments, so let's just get right to it.
Hello, word nerds. Daniel here from the Weird Alphabet again, here in your ear holes, here to tell you about more words from the dictionary. We are currently on page 77 still. Well, let's get on with those words. A tactic, A-T-A-C-T-I-C. Adjective from 1957, of, relating to, or being a polymer exhibiting no stereochemical regularity of structure. Example, atactic polypropylene, compared to the word isotactic. At Atlanta, noun from 14th century, a fleet-footed huntress in Greek mythology who challenges her suitors to a race and is defeated by Hippomenes when she stopped to pick up 3 golden apples she has dropped. Well, that's why you never pick up apples in a race. Otherwise, you'll lose. Then there's at all. Adverb from 14th century, in any way or respect, to the least extent or degree, under any circumstance. Example, doesn't smoke at all. Adaman, noun from 1835. No definition, just a synonym for heat man. Etymology, well, this is Russian. Huh. Adamasco lily, noun from 1743. Any of a genus of American bulbous herbs of the amaryllis family with pink, white, or yellowish flowers, especially one of the southeastern U.S. with white flowers, usually tinged with purple. The genus name is Zephyranthus. Etymology, from the Virginia Algonquin Atomosco. Atavism, noun from 1833. Definition 1A. Recurrence in an organism of a trait or character typical of an ancestral form and usually due to genetic recombination. 1B. Recurrence of a reversion to the past, style, manner, outlook, approach, or activity. Example, architectural atavism. Definition 2. One that manifests atavism. Synonym is throwback. Atavist is an adjective, and atavistically is an adverb. Etymology, from the Latin atavus, which means ancestor, from at, which is probably akin to the word atta, which means daddy, and avus, which means grandfather, and there's more at the word uncle. Ataxia, noun from 1670, an inability to coordinate voluntary muscle movements that is a symptom of some central nervous system disorder and injuries not due to muscle weakness. Called also an incoordination, ataxic is an adjective. Etymology, this is Greek, from tasian, which means to put together, and adding a at the beginning of tasian basically makes it the opposite. Okay. Telangiac tasia, noun from 1961, an inherited symptomatic disorder marked especially by progressive pathological changes in the nervous system resulting in loss of motor coordination and by increased susceptibility to cancer, especially of lymphoid tissue. At bat, noun from 1941, an official turn at batting charged to a baseball player except when the player walks, sacrifices, is hit by a pitch ball, or is interfered by the catcher. Example, 3 hits in 5 at bats. Then we have ATC, which is an abbreviation for air traffic control. Ooh, now we have 8, past tense of eat. And then we have 8, we have a few different pronunciations of it. It can be A-T, A-T, or A-T-E. Noun from 1583, a Greek goddess personifying foolhardy and ruinous impulse. All right, so 8 in the first form is a noun suffix. Then the first definition, one acted upon in a specific way. Example, distillate. Definition 2, a chemical compound or complex anion derived from a specific compound or element. Example, phenolate, especially salt or ester of an acid with a name ending in IC and not beginning with hydro. Example, borate. 8, second form, noun suffix. Definition 1, office, function, rank, group of persons holding a specified office or rank or having a specified function. Example, vicarate. Definition 2, state, dominion, jurisdiction. Example, emirate and canate. 8, third form, adjective, suffix, marked by having. Example, craniate. And then 8 in its fourth form, verb suffix, act on in a specific way. Example, insinuate, cause to be modified or affected by. Examples, camphorate, cause to become. Another example, activate, furnished with. And last example, capacitate. Okay, so I think the word of the day is going to be 8, and not just 8 as in the past form of eaten or eat, but the many ways that you can use 8 and how it's used in other words. So it's not just ATE, but dash ATE, combining with other words to create its definition. So yeah, the word of the day is going to be 8, A-T-E. And that'll be it for me. This is Daniel Kalka from the Weird Alphabet. You'll probably be hearing some other voices from the Weird Alphabet sometime soon. If you want to hear more of our voices and you want to hear us talk about Weird Al, you can check out our podcast, The Weird Alphabet. We are on iTunes, Spotify, and wherever you get your podcasts. So yeah. All right. Until next time. Goodbye.
Daniel, thank you very much for recording two episodes. I definitely plan to have you back and the rest of your co-hosts of the Weird Alphabet podcast. If any of you have never listened to that and you are a Weird Al fan, go ahead and listen to it. They all four have very different personalities, but it all comes together to create this amazing soup of Weird Al talking. And I want to sort of get their own personal takes on various words. Might be the letter A, might be the letter B. We shall find out. And so tomorrow you will be getting a different guest reader. It is Greg Simpson from the They Might Be Giants podcast called This Might Be a Podcast. I have mentioned both of these podcasts in the past, and now you get to hear their voices. Until next time. Wait, am I doing the intro or the outro? That was the outro. Until next time, this is Spencer and sometimes other people reading the dictionary. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this episode of the Dictionary Podcast. Today, you will be listening to the one and only Greg Simpson. I don't think he's related to Homer and Marge, but he's still a Simpson. Go ahead and listen to him talk right now.
Welcome to the dictionary. I am your guest host for today. My name is Greg Simpson, and I host my own podcast called This Might Be a Podcast, which is about the band They Might Be Giants. So if you're into They Might Be Giants, check out This Might Be a Podcast. Now on to the dictionary. We're on page 77. First word is not even a whole word. Aided. Adjective suffix. There's no definition of aided, but we have the third form of the suffix ate, as in pelated. Next word, atelectasis. Noun from 1859. Collapse of the expanded lung. Also, defective expansion of the pulmonary alveoli at birth. The etymology, from Greek ateles, which means incomplete or defective, plus ectasis, which means extension, from ectinine, which means to stretch out, from tinine, which means to stretch, and there's more at the word telos. Yeah. Next word, atelier. Atelier, noun from 1699, an artist's or designer's studio or workroom. Second definition, we just have the synonym workshop. Etymology, from Middle French estelier, which means woodpile, from estel, which means splinter. Ouch! Next word, edamoya, noun from 1914. A white pulped tropical fruit of a tree that is a hybrid of the sweet stop and the cherimoya. I have no idea what either of those are. Etymology. The eight is from eights, which means sweet stop, and the moya is from cherimoya. Okay, then. Next word. A tempo. Adverb or adjective from 1834. In time. It is used as a direction in music to return to the original tempo. Yes, I knew this one. Because I'm a music teacher. Even my kindergartners know what the word tempo means. T-E-M-P-O, and tempo was his name-o. In the etymology, this is Italian. Next word. Atemporal. Adjective from 1870. Independent of or unaffected by time. Synonym is timeless. As in, They Might Be Giants are a timeless band. Mm-hmm. Next word. Atenolol. Noun from 1972. A beta blocker, C14H22N2O3, used in the treatment of hypertension. I'm bad at science. Next word. ATF, which is an abbreviation for Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives. They left off the E. Next word. Athabascan. Noun from 1846. First definition, a family of American Indian languages spoken primarily in Western Canada, Alaska, and the U.S. Southwest. Second definition, a member of a people speaking an Athabascan language. Etymology, Athabasca is a Cree band from the Cree dialect word Athapascan. Got that wrong. Let's try that again. Athapascan, which is a name for the area east of Lake Athabasca, which literally means where there are reeds one after another. Next word, Athanasian. Adjective from 1586. Of or relating to Athanasius or his advocacy of the Homoousian doctrine against Arianism. Next word, Athanasian Creed. Noun from 1586. A Christian creed originating in Europe around AD 400 and relating especially to the Trinity and Incarnation. Next word is Majayam. Atheism. Noun from 1546. First definition, archaic. We just have the synonyms ungodliness and wickedness. That's me. Definition 2A. A disbelief in the existence of deity. Definition 2B. The doctrine that there is no deity. The etymology from Middle French, athemise, from athi, which means atheist, from Greek atheos, which means godless, which is from a plus theos, which means God. Next word, atheist, noun from 1551. It took them 5 years to go from atheism to get atheist. One who believes that there is no deity. Atheistic or atheistical are adjectives, and atheistically is an adverb. Next word, atheling, noun from before the 12th century. An Anglo-Saxon prince or nobleman, especially the heir apparent or a prince of the royal family. Etymology, from Old English, atheling, from elethilu, oh boy, from ethelu, which means nobility, and it's akin to the Old High German adal, which means nobility. Next word is Athena or Athene, noun from the 14th century. The Greek goddess of wisdom, compared to Minerva. And let's see, I'm supposed to pick a word of the episode. I think I'm going to go with ATF, Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, because it makes me think of Breaking Bad, which is a fantastic show, and I'm sure you all have seen it. If you haven't, what's wrong with you? So that'll do it for this episode of The Dictionary. Again, my name is Greg Simpson. Check out my podcast about They Might Be Giants if you want. It's called This Might Be a Podcast. Thanks for having me, Spencer. I'm out.
Thank you very much to Greg. We appreciate you. Who's we? It's just me. I'm the only one who's doing this. But sometimes I have the other. So all my past guest readers, we all appreciate you reading some words. And in tomorrow's episode, you will all be listening to Greg again. And maybe I will have him on in the future. Oh, and if you are listening this far, I actually have an episode on his podcast. I was a guest on This Might Be a Podcast, and I think that that episode might actually be airing right around the time that you are listening to this, first week of December 2019. So if you want to hear me talk more and to talk about some music stuff, go check out that. Until next time, this is Spencer and sometimes other people reading the dictionary. Goodbye.